From the end of the book of Genesis, I think we'll talk about Jacob again tonight, and then next week we'll start talking about Joseph, and we'll be wrapping up the book of Genesis and then moving into the book of Exodus to see what's there. And last Sunday evening, we talked about Jacob and Esau and the conflict that existed between them, most of which was because of the favoritism that their parents had. Jacob's dad favored Esau, Jacob's mother favored Jacob, and that caused a great deal of conflict and animosity. A great lesson for parents to learn in regard to parenting. Last Sunday night's message, if you haven't heard it, we'll be posting that on the internet very soon. And but be mindful that Jacob's career ended the way that God wanted it to end, regardless of how we appreciate or do not appreciate the personality and the acts and the exploits of Jacob. We do know that God's will was ultimately done. So tonight, we're going to look at a subject that is a little bit complicated because it might be something that's a little overused in the New Testament church, and I'll explain that in just a little bit. But I want you to turn to Genesis 32, verse 24. I'll begin reading there. Read down to the end of the chapter, okay? Genesis 32, 24. If you have your place there, you say amen.
Amen.
All right, it says that Jacob was left alone, and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh. And the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, "Let me go, for the day breaketh." And he said, Jacob said, "I will not let thee go, except thou bless me." He said unto him, "What is thy name?" And he said, "Jacob." And he said, "Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed." Jacob asked him and said, "Tell me, I pray thee, thy name." He said, "Wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name?" And he blessed him there. Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, "For I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved." And as he passed over Penuel, the sun rose upon him, and he halted upon his thigh. Therefore the children of Israel eat not of the sinew which shrank, which is upon the hollow of the thigh unto this day. Because he touched the hollow of Jacob's thigh and the sinew that shrank. Don't stop there at the end of the chapter. I'll be seated this evening. And for just a few brief moments, I want to talk to you about the subject of rededication. Rededication is an Old Testament concept. The reason that rededication is an Old Testament concept is quite simple. Backsliding is an Old Testament concept. The New Testament does not talk about the subject of backsliding. In fact, the term backsliding is a very rare term in all of the Bible. The New Testament doesn't talk about backsliding because most of the time, New Testament Christians don't have a problem backsliding. They never have slid and fall. And oftentimes, when we confess the sin of backsliding, we're really mislabeling the condition. New Testament Christians God is not as lenient with we who are New Testament Christians because we have the Holy Spirit. And for us to backslide, the Holy Spirit would have to backslide with us. So backsliding is not exactly a New Testament concept. However, because of the coming and going ministry of the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament, when the Spirit departed from Old Testament saints, there was often a condition that resulted from that known as backsliding. You might recall that David experienced a backslidden condition when he failed to read his Bible one morning, failed to go to war like he was supposed to one morning, and in that backslidden state, King David looked upon Bathsheba, lusted after her in his heart, and committed the scarlet sin of adultery, which was followed by her Bathsheba being with child, and then ultimately he had to murder Uriah the Hittite, the wife of Bathsheba, so that he could cover up the sin. And we're going to be talking about that in our church probably shortly, what it means to cover up sin and the penalty for covering up sin. The Bible says, "He that covereth his sin shall not prosper."
Right.
You hear that? "He that covereth his sin shall not prosper, but he that confesseth and forsaketh shall obtain mercy from the Lord."
Amen.
The church is not in the business of covering up sin. The church is in the business of exposing sin. Isn't that
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
And so David was a man who had experienced a certain degree of backsliding. Jacob is another Old Testament character that we can justifiably say had experienced a certain degree of backsliding in his life as well, and he bore the marks of it and paid the price. Jacob, of course, you know, lied on occasion. He deceived on occasion. He paid for that. You might remember that he got married one day, and boy, what a bumfoozle that was. You remember he served Laban. He served Laban for Rachel. He was head over heels, smitten. I'm talking about dumbfounded, Twitter-pated, smitten about Rachel. Couldn't get her off his mind. He served for 7 years. And he got married. And when he got married, listen to this, couple. So you ready for this? Hold on to your hairpiece. When he got married, he woke up the next morning, it wasn't Rachel, was it? It was Leah. So what happens to a lot of young couples?
Yeah.
They marry one person, but the next morning they wake up with somebody else.
How about that?
A wedding ring does a lot, though.
Amen.
Let's just let that ruminate for just a second. I preached a message one time on Mary and Rachel and waking up with Leah. That's the way it happens for a lot of women, too. A lot of times women marry a guy and they date him and court him. I don't even know where I'm talking about this. But they date him and court him, and when they're dating him and court him, he shaves and wears cologne.
Come on, brother.
And just as soon as they get married, he puts on 20 pounds, lays around on Saturday morning, lazes around on Saturday morning with a peck of popcorn and a 2-liter Pepsi and watches cartoons till 11 o'clock, and she married one guy but woke up with another. That's what happened with Jacob. Now watch what happened. Remember, Jacob was a swindler. Jacob was a man of exploitation, wasn't he?
Right.
This time the swindler got swindled. So what you sow, you will reap.
Amen.
You always reap after you sow, and you always reap what you sow.
Amen.
Jacob was a swindler. He got swindled. Laban, his father-in-law, really pulled the wool over Jacob's eyes. But you know what? Jacob's love for Rachel was so deep that instead of walking out on Leah and forbidding Leah, the older sister, instead of walking out on Leah and forbidding Leah, you know what he did? Jacob served 7 more years so that he could get the bride that he actually wanted. You know why? Because love is worth waiting for.
Amen.
Isn't that right? Now understand something with me. Jacob reaped. Don't try what Jacob tried. Don't explore in the areas that Jacob went into, because I'm going to tell you something. Jacob paid a high price. He paid a very costly price for the sins that he committed and for the deeds that he did. And there came a time in Jacob's life, watch this, the Bible says in verse number 24 that Jacob found himself alone one night. Now, a backslidden person really feels uncomfortable when they're alone. A backslidden person cannot live with himself. A backslidden person is sickened by their own image in the mirror. And when they find themselves alone, that is to say, when there's nobody to distract them from the backsliddenness, and there's no one to talk to and keep their mind on something else, when they find themselves alone and they have to face themselves in the mirror, watch this, their regrets begin to surface, and all of their human condition begins to surface, and I'm telling you, it floods in on them all at one time, and they find themselves in a great, great valley of despair, and they find themselves with a need to rededicate. Is Jacob a believer? Of course he's a believer, but he's wandered far away from God. He has yielded up his spiritual man to fleshly lust, to fleshly desires. Does this sound familiar? He's yielded himself up to fleshly lust and fleshly desires, and he finds himself dirty, he finds himself unrepentant, and he seeks to evade that, and he seeks to avoid that, but the unavoidable and the inevitable finally happens. He finds himself alone one night. And God pays Jacob a visit. Now, what will make you want to rededicate? 3 or 4 or 5 or 10 or 15 or 16 things that will be done before Waffle House closes. Number one, regrets from the past will make rededication possible. Listen to it. Regrets from the past. It was Arthur Pink who said, the scriptures are plain and explicit on the point that one who has been born again cannot be unborn. An unfaithful and unworthy child of God I may be, but I am still his child nevertheless. Did Jacob lose his salvation? No. Did Jacob need to be reborn? No. But he did need to rededicate. He needed to get back on track. Now, why does someone need to rededicate? I'll tell you why. If you'll take the time tonight and do a homework assignment, read verses 1 through 23 of this 32nd chapter, and you're going to see, watch this, that Jacob has been living in fear that sooner or later, one day, Esau's going to catch up with him. Sooner or later, one day, Esau is going to come to collect. Sooner or later, Esau has promised, remember last Sunday night, Esau has promised, the next time I see you, you're going to be a dead man. Yeah. So Jacob, watch this. One thing that creates a need and creates the crisis that leads to rededication is our past. Let me help you with your past. Are you ready for it? Don't run from it. Let it cure you. Your past will cure you of your pride.
Amen.
Now, I'm one of these preachers. I don't believe in giving the devil a commercial. We had a lady stood up one time at our youth camp, and she said, oh, I have slept with dozens of men. Boy, I just went, ugh. And she talked about the drugs, and she talked about the affairs, and she talked about the wickedness. And here we are at a youth camp with 175 teenagers, and I want to go down there and grab her by the neck and say, please, we don't want to give the devil a commercial and glory in your past. Your past is not something you're supposed to be living in and wallowing in and bragging about. Your past is supposed to be a cure for your pride.
Yeah, amen.
Am I right about that?
Amen.
I think I am. Regrets from the past will make rededication possible. Watch this. In verses 1 through 23, Jacob was living a false life. Jacob was living a fugitive life. Jacob was living a failing life. I'm telling you, there were holes in the bottom of Jacob's bucket. And every time he tried to get his life irrigated and watered, he kept reliving the episode with Esau. And he knew sooner or later this is going to catch up. You know what you need to do when your past is catching up to you? Rededicate. Now, a lot of us New Testament Christians, if we're not careful, we'll try to get saved again. Are you listening? Watch this now. Stay with me. Jacob rededicated because he was afraid of what was ultimately going to happen with him and Esau, but that didn't stop him from having to face Esau. Rededication is not a magic wand that just takes away the problem. Rededication. Can I get a witness on that? Rededication is not a magic wand that just makes all that you've done disappear and you don't have to reap. Rededication means right. So when Esau does show up, I'll be ready.
Right, brother.
By the way, in chapter 33, Esau did show up.
Amen.
When Esau showed up, watch this. He came walking up with 400 soldiers. And son, I'm telling you, Jacob took Rachel and her children and sent them this way. And Leah and her children sent them that way. And said, y'all better go and scatter and hide in the woods. Because when Esau gets to me, he's going to kill me as dead as last year's bird's nest. When Esau showed up, what does it say happened? Esau's old chin started quivering. That big old hairy man threw his arms around his brother and said, time has made a change.
Yes, amen.
Jacob, I miss you. And Jacob threw his arms around Esau and said, Esau, I miss you. You know what? Jacob and Esau got right. Rededication doesn't mean you're going to have to, listen, rededication doesn't mean you're not going to have to face Esau, but I'll tell you what it does mean is when you're rededicated, God might do some things in Esau's heart.
Amen.
That's right.
Can I get a witness? There's a second thing here. First of all, regrets from the past will make rededication possible. Number two, rigorous persuasion will make rededication possible. What do you mean? Look at verse 24. Jacob was left alone. And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. Now he's getting no rest. He's unsettled. Why? Something has attacked Jacob in the night. Isn't that what happens when you're living with guilt? Isn't that what happens when you're living with this lingering, looming need of ominous rededication? Isn't that what happens? You can't rest because you're wrestling with it, you're fighting with it, you're struggling with it. Is that right?
Amen.
Come into church, your eyes are bloodshot and red. You come to church and you're yawning and you're tired and you're wore out because you can't rededicate or you won't rededicate. And God is wrestling with you in the night and taking away your sleep in the night. Listen to me. Don't just waste away and ruin your health wrestling with God. Just get it right. Just rededicate.
Amen.
Watch this. Verse 24, he's alone. He can't sleep. Verse 25, when he saw that he prevailed not against him. Isn't that the way it happens? You're fighting a losing battle. He saw that he's not winning. He's not prevailing. What does it say? He touched the hollow of his thigh. The hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. Watch this. What, are you ready for this, church? There's an injury. There's an injury here that results from Jacob's unwillingness to rededicate. And I'm telling you, when we wrestle with God, when we resist, now of course I understand here that Jacob is wrestling with God because Jacob's tired and he don't want to let God go. I understand the circumstances are somewhat different here. But oftentimes, you remember what David said in Psalm 32? He said, my sleep is taken away from me. He said, my bones waxed old from my roaring all the day long. He said, my moisture is turned into drought of summer. He said, he began to talk about psychosomatic symptoms because David was living in sin and David was living with private problems and private sin, unconfessed sin. And what David should have done is went before Nathan instead of waiting for Nathan to come to him.
Right,
brother. But it took Nathan coming and rebuking David to get David to finally rededicate. When he rededicated, listen to this now. The sweetest songs that David wrote came after he rededicated.
Right.
And I'm telling you, your sweetest songs and your most enjoyable church services and your greatest experience with God and the most wonderful wisdom of the Word is waiting for you and I if we would just be willing to yield.
Amen.
God wrestling with Jacob. He said, Jacob, I'm here. It's time to fight. You ever had God show up that way? You ever had God show up and say, Brad, I'm here. We're not here to bless. We're not here to learn. We're here to fight. You ever duked it out with God and won? top, doesn't he?
Amen.
If you're wrestling with God tonight, I'm telling you, it's a foolish match. God wrestling with Jacob. God weakening Jacob. Watch this. God said, I'm going to do something to you that's going to cause you to never walk right again. And God touched the hollow, that would be the inner part of his thigh. God touched the hollow of Jacob's thigh and shrunk a ligament. And when he shrunk that, Jacob is now a handicap. And we see him from here on limping along. He can't walk as fast as he used to walk. He's not the soldier he used to be. He's not the lover he used to be. He's not the daddy that he used to be. You know why? Because he resisted God and waited so long to rededicate that God had to injure him. God wrestling with Jacob. God weakening Jacob. One author said it like this, quote, he said, in recognized weakness lies our strength. Listen to that again. In recognized weakness lies our strength. His strength may be perfected in our conscious and realized weakness. Sometimes we may have to look at God and say, Lord, injure me. Now, the New Testament, he says, if thy hand offend thee, what? Cut it off. If thy right eye offend thee, by the way, Sister Nancy, plug your ears up right here. He said, if thy right eye offend thee, sorry, sister, you're a lefty and you'll get over it when you get to heaven. God straighten all that out. If he said, if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out. That's the eye of power. He said, if thy right hand offend thee, that's the most useful hand to the Jew. He said, what? Cut it off. You know what God is saying? If your physical appetites, if the eye gate or what you are working for and reaching for is hindering you spiritually, he said, you need to injure yourself. And in this case, God came down and injured Jacob. He weakened his thigh. Of course, no one can wrestle with their hip socket dislocated. So you know what's happening? After he touched the hollow of Jacob's thigh, after he injured Jacob's thigh, the wrestling match is virtually over, isn't it? Wouldn't you imagine so? The wrestling match is basically over. Now Jacob's just hanging on. He's grabbing and lashing out and gripping this angel of the Lord, and Jacob is just hanging on. Jacob's just hanging on. Listen to me. Don't give up and fall out. Don't get out on a myth limb. Don't give up and walk away. Let God injure you if he has to. Let God do whatever it takes to get your attention if he has to. And I'm telling you, if you'll just cling to God, if you'll just hold on to God, I'm going to tell you something, friend. There'll come a day you'll thank God for that injury.
Praise the Lord. Yes.
I can't tell you how many people have said, thank God I got in the hospital. Because I wouldn't look up. How many of us, our vertical hold is messed up? So you old timers know what I'm talking about. You remember that knob on the back of your television?
Amen.
It's called what? The vertical hold. Whoever the ignoramus was that put that knob on the back of the television, you young people are looking around saying, I have no idea what you're talking about. Let me tell you. Back in the day, they used to call the television the tube. Because it had electrical tubes in it. Quite a dangerous thing. I remember on stormy days in South Georgia, if it was real cloudy outside, you touched your TV, it shot you.
Yeah.
Remember those? It's God's way of trying to tell us this thing ain't right. We didn't learn. Amen? I'm not against television. When I hear preachers preach against us, I get rid of one mind. But every time I hear preachers preach against television, I get rid of one mind. Tough crowd tonight. Anyway. So the vertical hole was on the back of that television. Man, I tell you, those old mobile homes we lived in, man, I was raising a pink mobile home. 14 by 70 pink mobile home.
Down the back door.
A lot of questions being answered tonight. We come stomping through that house. We come stomping through that house. And you know, you remember how when the washing machine get a little cattywampus in those old mobile homes? And that washing machine go, whoop, 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 and the whole house would just go chill. Some of y'all raised a spoon in your mouth. You ain't even lived yet.
Yeah.
If the floor got shaking just right, it'd mess up the vertical hole. That thing would go to rolling. Just go to rolling. You'd go up and try to adjust the vertical hole, and just about the time you think you got it right, it would roll. You're watching Andy Griffith, and that thing would roll up and it'd hold. And you step back real gently, try to make it back from the couch. When you sat down, what would it do?
Go the other way.
Man, that stinking thing, it rolled, and the bar would stop right in the middle, and Andy's bottom is on the top, and Andy's top is on the bottom.
Yeah.
You know what's wrong with a lot of us? You know what's wrong with us? Our horizontal hole is perfect.
Come on, brother. That's good right there.
I preach myself under conviction. Mm. Our horizontal hold is perfect, but our vertical hold is making our head swing. Mm. You know what you need? You know what I need? I need to rededicate.
Amen.
Get your vertical hold right. Let God adjust you. You don't need to get saved again. You just need to rededicate. Let God adjust you. Now watch what happens. I gotta hurry. Look at verse 27.
Reach on, bro.
Look at verse 27. God has a question. Now I wrote a thesis for one of my degrees. I wrote a thesis paper on a new hermeneutic. I called it the hermeneutic of divine question. When God asks a question, why does he do that? Let me give you an example. Adam! Where art thou? You think God didn't know where Adam was? No, Adam didn't know where Adam was.
That's right.
And so God said, Adam, where are you? So that Adam would say, I'm right here. Out of God's will. I'm standing right here, Lord. I listened to the wrong information, and I'm out of God's will. And God said, exactly. I'll give you another one. Jacob, what is your name? You think God didn't know Jacob's name? Of course he knew his name. He wants Jacob to say that. You remember last week? The name Jacob means what? Thief, supplanter, healer. So verse 27, what is thy name? And Jacob is clinging to the leg of the angel of the Lord. His hip is out of joint, and he's clinging to that leg. And he says, tell me your name, Jacob. Tell me your name. Say it, Jacob. Admit what you are. Say it out loud. Go ahead and say it. Jacob tightens up, and he says, I'm Jacob. I'm a thief. You know, you're never going to get right with God until you say what you are.
Well, that's good, brother.
Amen.
Jacob, what is your name? Verse 27, without comment, without elaboration, he says, Jacob. Oh, the story doesn't stop. Verse 28.